الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وقال جل وعلا: يسألك الناس عن الساعة قل إنما علمها عند الله. فقال جل وعلا في مقام آخر: يسألونك عن الساعة أيان مرساها فيما أنت من ذكراها إلى ربك منتهاها. My respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. July 1999, the false French prophet of the 16th century was on the lips of everybody, Muslim, non-Muslim alike. And if you remember, he made the media big time. The TV, the newspapers, the magazines, the radio. Everybody around the globe was talking about one person, Nostradamus, and his prediction that the world was going to end. Now, in spite that the majority of his predictions that he made in the past proved to be wrong, in spite of this, many people really began to believe that the world was really going to end the day he predicted. To the extent that some kuffar left their homes looking for a safe haven, looking for a refuge, looking for a place which will save them from this disaster. In this very city, Leeds, what did we see? We saw the New Age travelers in the middle of your city center, sitting in a neat round circle with their heads down and all their luggage waiting for the world to end. It was sad to hear that this prediction of Nostradamus proved strong enough that it created doubt and rocked the iman of some Muslims with regards to when the world will end. And if you remember, there was thunder on that night, and there was lightning in many places, and this really increased fear in those weak people that really believed that the world was going to end. But did the world end? The world did not end. And now we have the millennium around the corner. We have the millennium around the corner, and many kuffar have begun to believe that the millennium will bring with it the end of the world. Because some of the kuffar believe that on the turn of the millennium, Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam will descend from the heavens. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam will descend from the heavens and there will be a great war, and thus the world will end. Not only have they begun to believe this, many Christians from the States, the United States of America, have begun to move to Palestine, to Baitul Maqdis, to the Mount of Olives, as they believe this is where Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam is going to descend. So they are moving to Palestine because they want to witness this event. They want to see Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam come down from the heavens. And come the millennium, the Muslims yet again will be tested. And yet again the Muslims will ask one another, is the world really going to end? What does Islam say about the ending of the world? Listen very carefully to what the Quran says. The Quran says, يَسْأَلُكَ النَّاسُ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ قُلْ إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they ask you regarding the hour. Qiyamah, when will Qiyamah come? Tell them, its knowledge is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet again the Quran says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا فِيمَا أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَاهَا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَاهَا. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they ask you regarding the hour when it will occur. Allah says, tell them that it is not the business of any prophet to tell its exact time. Why? Because no prophet knows when Qiyamah will take place. Its knowledge is only with the same being who created this world. The hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, and Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, a man came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akhbirni anil iman. Tell me, what is iman? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, an tu'mina billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubi wa rusulih wal yawm al-akhir wal qadri khayri wa sharrih wal ba'thi ba'da al-maw. Believe in Allah, believe in His angels, believe in His books, His messengers, believe in fate, good and bad, and believe in life after death. This is iman. The stranger posed another question to Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam, to Ya Rasulullah, tell me, what is Islam? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة وتصوم رمضان وتحج البيت إن استطعت إليه سبيلا. Testify there is no God worthy of worship and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Offer your prayers and give your zakat. Fast in the month of Ramadan and perform Hajj if you have the means. This is Islam. The third question he posed to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell me, mal ihsan? What is ihsan? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى فإن لم تكن ترى فإنه يرى. That worship Allah with such concentration as if you can see Allah. And if you cannot get to this stage, then worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knowing that the Almighty is watching every action. This is ihsan. Yes, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now tell me, mata sa'a? When is the hour? When will Qiyamah take place? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the stranger, mal mas'oolu anha bi'a'lam min as-sa'ir. That the one questioned has no more knowledge about Qiyamah than the one that has questioned. Meaning the questioner and know the one that has questioned knows anything about Qiyamah when it will take place. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, I will inform you of its time. إِذَا وَلَدَتِ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّهَا. When a slave girl gives birth to her master, and when poor shepherds begin to construct lofty big buildings, then six, the hour is close. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there are five things that nobody has the knowledge of which besides the Almighty Himself. When in the very same gathering He recited the verse of the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ إِلْمُ السَّعْ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدَى وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. The first, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ إِلْمُ السَّعْ. The knowledge when the world will end is only with Allah. وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ. It is He who sends down the rain. The second it will rain, the location it will rain, how many drops of rain will fall, where they will fall, this knowledge is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. He knows what is inside the womb. Every womb in dunya, whether it is the womb of a human being or the womb of some animal, what is inside this womb the day the egg fertilizes and before this, Allah, it is in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether a child will be born, whether this child will be male or female, the knowledge is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What you will do tomorrow, how much you will earn, and where you will die, the knowledge of these five things are only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The question left, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, bring him back. The Sahaba looked for this person, but they could not find him. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, that was Sayyidina Jibra'il. ذَا يُعَلِّمُكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. He came to teach you your deen. From this ahadith and the verses of the Quran, it is clearly evident that nobody besides Allah, no being besides Allah knows when the world is going to end. No kafir, no Nostradamus, no wali, no shaheed, and no prophet to the extent our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also did not know and does not know when the world will end. The only being that knows when the world will end is the being that created this world, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One thing is for certain, Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam and the Quran has taught us that the time has come very close for the world to end. If you open the book of Allah, you will find the Quran announcing. 1400 years ago the Quran said, وَمَا يُدْرِيكْ لَعَلَّ السَّاعَةَ تَكُونُ كَرِيبًا. And what do you know? Perhaps the time of the hour has come close. The Quran says, اِقْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ. That reckoning draws near for mankind. The time for hisab, the time to stand in front of Allah the Almighty and to pay the price of sin and disobedience, that time has come close. Yet again the Quran says, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرِ. That the Qiyamah has come close and the moon has split. Many of the signs that Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam predicted that will take place before Qiyamah have already appeared. The fire of Hijaz has already appeared. The hadith authentic, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كَلَا تَقُومُ السَّاعَ حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ نَارٌ مِنْ أَرْضِ الْحِجَازِ تضيء أناق الإبل ببصرة. That Qiyamah will not come till a great fire will come out from the land of Hijaz, and this fire will shed light on the necks of the camels traveling in the land of Busra. Busra is a city near Damascus. That this fire will be so great and its light will be so great that these camels in the land of Busra will be able to walk in its light. 600 years after Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam died, this prediction proved true. Around 800 years ago, this fire of Hijaz came out. In the latter part of the Abbasi rule, 2 years before the Tarsus destroyed Baghdad, the great Imam Qurtubi writes regarding this fire, he writes that this fire came out from outside the city of Madinatul Munawwarah. at the place of Quraiza called Harra, a city wall also side, on Wednesday the 3rd of Jamadi Ustani, 654 Hijri. They write that this fire, it looked like as if it was a huge city in which its minarets, towers and forts were appearing. It was 12 miles long, 4 miles wide, and around 2.5 man stature high. He writes, it seemed as if there were two canals inside this fire, one red and one green, which thundered like clouds, and a mountain of ash had risen on account of it. Qazi Sinan says, when this huge fire was outside Madinah al-Munawwara, I came to the Amir of Madinah at the time and I said to him, he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as this is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says the Amir of Madinah freed all his slaves. He gave back to people what was due to them. He stopped collecting tax. And he and all the people of Medina spent Saturday night in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam crying and begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Allah's mercy and begging for Allah's forgiveness till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finally turned this fire away from the people of Medina to Al-Munawwara. It had strange characteristics. There's a huge city of fire outside Medina to Al-Munawwara, and what is inside Medina to Al-Munawwara? Because of the barakat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a cold breeze inside Madinah al-Munawwara, and this city of fire is having no effect on the city of Madinah al-Munawwara. Fire does not burn stone. The mu'arrikhin, the historians write that this fire burns every stone and every mountain it passed through. Fire burns wood. The historians write that this fire had no effect on wood. No effect on wood whatsoever. Allama Qattalani, who was in Hijaz at the time when this fire broke out, he wrote a book on this fire. He writes that I was informed that there was a huge stone. Half of this stone was inside the sacred area, the Haram, and half of this stone was outside the sacred area. He writes the fire came and only burned the half that was outside the Haram. The half that was inside the Haram, the fire did not touch. He writes, a man put out his arrow to this fire. It only burned the arrowhead and didn't touch the remainder, which was made out of wood. He writes, its light was such that the people of Medina would work during the night as if it were day. And the light of this fire could be seen all the way from Makkah to al-Mukarrama, the mountains of Makkah. For those that have been to Hijaz, the distance between Makkah and Medina is over 400 kilometers. The light of this fire could be seen all the way from Makkah to al-Mukarrama and all the way from Busra. And this is how the prediction of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam proved true 600 years after Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam left this world. Another sign which has already appeared is the plague of Amwat. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, oh, there's system bayna yadi sa'a. He count and prepare for six things before Qiyamah. One of the things Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in this hadith was that an epidemic will hit you just like the one that spreads amongst sheep and herds of animals. The great master of hadith Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani writes that this took place in the plague of Amwat in the reign of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, after the conquest of Bayt al-Maqdis. He writes that the plague started in the city of Amwat, which is in Palestine. Then this plague spread in the whole of Syria, Iraq and Misr. The leader of the Muslims at the time was Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala an was informed about this plague, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala an himself left Madinah al-Munawwara to find out details about this plague. When he reached a place called Sar, the Mujahideen that were already there, the leaders of the Mujahideen, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan, Shurabil ibn Hasna, came to meet the Amir al-Mu'mineen to inform him of the severeness of this plague and to tell him to return and not to come to the infected area. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu gathered the Muhajireen and asked what he should do. Some of the Muhajirin said that he should continue his journey and go to the infected area, while some of the Muhajirin said that Amir al-Mu'mineen should return to Madinatul Munawwara and not come to where the plague is. Sayyidina Umar gathered the Ansar and asked for their opinion. The Ansar, like the Muhajirin, differed amongst themselves. Some said that the Amir al-Mu'mineen should continue the journey, while others said that he should return to Madinatul Munawwara. Sayyidina Umar gave preference to return to Madinatul Munawwara. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah was very strict in the masala of taqdeer. When he saw Sayyidina Umar returning, he said, "Oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, afiraran min qadarillah. Oh Umar, are you running away from the fate of Allah, from the taqdeer of Allah?" Sayyidina Umar, who was very wise, answered, "Na'am, firaran min qadarillah ila qadarillah." That Umar is running away from the taqdeer of Allah to the taqdeer of Allah. He explained, "Oh Abu Ubaidah, if a valley has two sides, one is very rich and productive, very fertile, and the other is very dry. If a man comes and herds his sheep in the rich area, does he not do it with the taqdeer of Allah? And the one who takes his animals to the dry area, does he not also do it with the taqdeer of Allah?" Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah understood. Next day, Abdurrahman ibn Auf came, who had not visited the Amir al-Mu'mineen the day before. He heard what had happened and he said, "Oh Umar, do not worry, because I have heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, كَإِذَا سَمِئْتُمْ بِهَذَا الْوَبَاءِ بِبَلَدٍ فَلَا تَقْدَمُوا عَلِهِ وَإِذَا وَقَعَ وَأَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَلَا تَخْرُجُوا فِرَارًا مِنْهِ." Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when you hear that there is a plague in a city, then do not go to that city. But if it takes place while you are already there, then Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said that you should not leave this place. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was very pleased that he had made the right decision according to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu returned to Madinatul Munawwara, he was informed of the damage this plague was causing. He wrote a letter to Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. كَسَلَامٌ عَلَيْكَ فإنه قد أرضت لي إليك حاجة وأريد أن أشافهك فيه، فأزمت عليك إذا نظرت في كتابي هذا ألا تدعه من يدك حتى تقبل إلي. That something has come up. As soon as you read my letter reaches you, come to مدينة المنورة. Listen to the reply. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah replied, "O Amir al-Mu'mineen, I know why you are calling me. You are calling me because you want to save the life of one who is not going to live. I cannot leave the Muslims to die by themselves. I hope you will excuse me." 25,000 Mujahideen died from this plague. Great Sahabas like Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, Sayyidina Mu'az ibn Jabal, Shurabil ibn Hassana, Fawl ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'een, all died from this plague. And this is how the prediction of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proved true, that you will be, that a plague will hit you, an epidemic will hit you, just like the one that spreads amongst animals and goats. Another sign that has already appeared, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates that I was with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on a journey. We halted at a place. Some of us put up our tents, while some of us began to compete with one another in shooting. And some of us began to take our animals for grazing. When all of a sudden a call of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called out, "As-salatu jami'atun, as-salatu jami'atun." "O Muslim, come for prayer, come for prayer." The Sahaba say, we gathered around Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "لم يكن نبي قبلي إلا كان حقا عليه أن يدل أمته على خير ما يعلمه لهم وينذرهم من شر ما يعلمه لهم." That every prophet that has come before me, it was the duty of this prophet to guide his followers and to tell them what he knew was good for them and warn them of what he knew was bad for them. As for your ummah, وَإِنَّ أُمَّتَكُمْ هَذِهِ جُعِلَ آفِيَتُهَا فِي أَوَّلِهَا. Your ummah, its days of peace, its days of security are in its early phase. As for the last phase of this ummah, it will be afflicted with calamities and trials and fitna, with things that this ummah will dislike. And we are seeing at this moment in time, the Muslims are being beaten all over the world. One country after another, the Muslims are being wiped out. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whosoever wishes to enter Jannah and save himself from the fire of hell, he should die in such a state that he believes in Allah and he believes in the last day. One hadith. The second hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he says that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was facing the east, and while facing the east, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا إِنَّ الْفِتْنَ هَا هُنَا أَلَا إِنَّ الْفِتْنَ هَا هُنَا مِنْ حَيْثُ يَطْلَعُ قَرْنُ الشَّيْطَانِ. That the fitna is here, it will start from here, referring to the east, where the devil's horns rise. In these ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us two things. A, this ummah will be afflicted with many trials and fitna. And secondly, the majority of these fitna will come from the east. How true Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. Many fitnas have come and gone, and the majority of these fitna came from the east. If you open the books of history, the fitna Zardastiyya came from the east. The Manawiyya came from the east. Buziyya, east. Hindusiyya, east. Qadianiyya, east. Baha'iyya, east. At this moment in time, we have atheism and communism in the east. And before the end of time, the Dajjal and the Ya'juj and Ma'juj will also come from the east. One fitna that is worth mentioning and also came from the east was the fitna of the Tartars. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the hour will not come till you, the Muslims, will fight the Turk. Be the eyes. Their cheeks will be red. Their noses will be flat. And their faces will look like as if layers of hide had been placed upon them. The hour will not come till you will fight a people whose sandals will be made of hair. The people referred to in this ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam were the Tartars who came from Turkestan and descended upon the Muslims in the year 656 Hijri, around 800 years ago. The Tartars committed so much bloodshed and murdered so many Muslims that to this very day, nobody has committed such bloodshed. Tajuddin writes in his Tabaqat, he writes, لَمْ يَكُنْ مُنْزُ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الدُّنْيَا فِتْنَةً أَكْبَرُ مِنْ فِتْنَةِ السَّطَّارِ. Now from the day Allah created this dunya, there has never been a fitna bigger than the fitna of the Tartars. He writes, فَإِنَّهُمْ خَرَّبُوا الْمَسَاجِدِ. They destroyed the houses of Allah. They broke all the masajid. They burned all the holy Qur'an. They burned all the books of tariq, the books of hadith. They burned the books of fiqh. They burned the commentaries of the Qur'an. They killed the men and they did not spare the women. Those women that were expecting, they would rip open their stomach and they would take the Muslim child and they would take off his head. Ibn Khaldun writes that in Baghdad alone, they slaughtered 16 lakh Muslims. We're talking 800 years ago when there were no tanks, no aeroplanes. They slaughtered 16 lakh Muslims, that is 1.6 million Muslims in Baghdad alone. The total population of Baghdad at the time was 2 million Muslims. The 4 lakh that remained, the majority were Shia. As for the Sunni Muslims, they slaughtered 1.6 million Muslims. They killed the Khalifa at the time, Mu'tasim Billah, and left him under the feet of animals. It is written in the books of history that the Muslims were so scared of their women, the Turk women, that when they saw a Turk woman, they would begin to shake. It is written in the books of history that if a Turk woman passed by 12 to 14 Muslim men, these men would begin to shake. She would go home She would tell them to wait there. This woman would go home. She would bring a sword. She would tell the Muslim men to bow in ruku, and she would take their heads off one by one, and these Muslims would not move. Ibn Khaldun writes that they stole so much treasure from the royal palaces in Baghdad that it cannot be described. Qutbuddin al-Hanafi writes that they burnt so many Muslim books and threw so many Muslim books in the river Dajla that the color of the river became black because of the ink in the books. There were so much books inside the river that a bridge formed over which people would walk. This is how true Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's prophecy came. Many signs have appeared. Many signs are appearing at this moment in time. We are seeing them and we are witnessing them with our very own eyes. A sign that we are seeing at this moment in this time is the highly decoration of masajid and boasting with regards to this. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا تَخُونُ سَاعَ حَتَّى يَتَبَاهَ النَّاسُ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. That Qiyamah will not come till you will see people boasting with one another with regards to the masajid. At this moment in time, we have over 1,000 masajid in England. The cost of some is millions. But what do we find inside the masajid? The beauty of the masjid lies with its people, with the Muslims coming for their 5 daily prayers. But what you will find in this handful of masajid is, in these thousands of masajid, you will find a handful of Muslims. The mosques are empty. The only day the mosque is full is on a Jumu'ah. 5 daily prayers and you will find a handful of Muslims. In Fajr Salah, you will find a few Muslims. Yet within the locality, we'll have over 10,000 Muslims. The masajid have become a place in which where the Muslims are looking for power, are looking for position. People want to become committee members. People want to become presidents of masajid, trustees of masajid. But they will not fulfill their obligation with regards to the masajid. They have no concern whatsoever with the Muslim youth, the backbone and the future of Islam in England. Another sign which we are witnessing today in its true colors is that Muslims are only making salam with the Muslims they know. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَشْرَاطِ السَّاعَةِ أَنْ يُسَلِّمَ الرَّجُلْ عَلَى رَجُلْ لَا يُسَلِّمْ عَلَيْهِ إِلَّا لِلْمَعْرِفَةِ. That one of the signs of Qiyamah is that a Muslim will make salam to another Muslim only because he knew him. At this moment in time we see this. We will walk down the street and we will see 100 Muslims, but who will we make salam to? We will only make salam to those Muslims that we know. We will not greet the other Muslims with salam, the ones that we do not know. Yet Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said that it is a duty of every Muslim to greet every Muslim, whether he knows him or whether he does not know him, to greet him with salam, as this will create love between the Muslims. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تدخل الجنة حتى تؤمن. That you will never enter Jannah till you believe. وَلَا تُؤْمِنُوا حَتَّى تَحَابُوا. And you cannot believe till you love one another. أَوَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ شَيْءٍ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَبْتُمْ. O Muslims, shall I not tell you of a thing? That when you do this thing, you will begin to love one another. أَفْشُ السَّلَامَ بَيْنَكُمْ. That spread salam amongst you and you will begin to love one another. Another sign that we are seeing that is appearing at this moment in time is the keeping of the Arab style beard, where the sides are shaven and there is only hair on the chin. It's a sign of Qiyamah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَكُونُ فِي آخِرِ الزَّمَانِ قَوْمٌ يَخْضِبُونَ بِالسَّوَاءِ كَحَوَاسِلِ الْحَمَامِ لَا يُرِيحُونَ رَاحَةَ الْجَنَّةِ. At the end of time, you will see a people who will use the black dye like the cubs of doves, and these people will not enter Jannah, they will not smell the fragrance of Jannah. Sheikh Yusuf ibn Abdullah, who's written a book on the signs of Qiyamah, writes, to me, this hadith means what I see today, where people shave the sides of the beard and only keep hair on their chin. And especially in the Arab countries, then they dye this hair that is on the chin. So it looks dark, black. And it looks like the crops of dolls. He says, this is what the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means to me. And we are seeing this in the Arab, in the Arab world, it is widespread. Many of the youth in England keep this type, this style, in which where they are making fun of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they are totally going against the teachings of Rasulullah, and according to Sheikh Yusuf ibn Abdullah, it is a sign of chaos. Another sign that we are seeing at this moment in time is the breaking of family ties, breaking of relations. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said, inna bayna yadi sa'qatul arham. That before Qiyamah you will see people will break relations. We are seeing at this moment in time people are breaking family ties like never before. A little argument, a petty thing which occurred between two relations, they will stop visiting one another. They will stop their children from visiting. They will stop their children from playing with the other children. They will stop speaking to one another, yet they live in the same city, they live in the same street, and months and years will pass. There is no such thing as making up. Why? Because we all suffer from the same thing that the devil suffered from. Pride and arrogance. Okay, why should I go to him and ask for forgiveness and make up with him? He should come to me. He should come to my house and ask for forgiveness, and then we will speak to one another. We live a life of sin in which we will be happy to backbite about the relative and talk evil to him, but we will not go up and make up as Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam taught. Never mind relations, in the same house, the sons of the same father will not speak to one another because of some petty argument or some petty thing that occurred between two brothers. The daughters of the same mother will not speak to one another. Father will not speak to his son, mother will not speak to his daughter. Yet Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said, كَلَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ كَاتِ وَرَحِمْ. Now one who breaks his family ties, he's not going to enter Jannah, do as he please. مَنْ حَجَّرْ أَخَاهُ فَوْكَ ثَلَاثْ فَمَا تَدَخَلَ النَّارِ. Whoever stops speaking to his Muslim brother for more than 3 days, and then this person dies, then this person will not go to Jannah, he will enter the fire of hell. We are seeing these signs appear before our very own eyes. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam told us 1400 years ago that we will see these things happening. We are seeing these things happening, and yet we are not taking a lesson. We are not taking a heed from this. We are living a life that we do, a life of sin and a life of neglect. Yet whatever Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam taught, we are seeing. Nostradamus makes one prediction and we are affected by this more than the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet the teachings of Nostradamus and his prediction, 99% of his predictions came wrong. And if one person can, and if any person in the whole of dunya can prove to me one prediction of Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam that came wrong, I will become his ghulam, I will become his slave. Every prediction Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam made, we are seeing with our very own eyes. Having said this, this does not mean Qiyamah will take place on the turn of the millennium, nor does it mean that Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam will descend at the turn of the millennium. Though majority of the signs have appeared and are appearing at this moment in time, there are many signs of Qiyamah which have still not appeared. One of the signs that has not appeared in its true colors is that beasts, animals, will begin to speak to people just like human beings. Man's own limbs will speak to him and inform him what his family has been doing in his absence. The hadith reported by Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala, he says that a shepherd was grazing his goats. A wolf came and took a goat. The shepherd chased him and snatched his goat back off him. The wolf climbed on a hill and began to speak to him loudly. أَمَتَّ إِلَىٰ رِزْكٍ رَزَقَنِهِ اللَّهِ إِنْ تَزَعْتَهُ مِنِّي. That you have taken the provision that Allah has provided to me, you have taken the food and snatched it, what Allah has given me. The shepherd was surprised. فَاللَّهِ إِنْ رَأَيْتُكَ الْيَوْمِ زِئْبًا يَتَكَلَّمْ. A wolf is speaking like a human being. The wolf replied, أَعْجَ مِنْ هَذَا رَجُلٌ فِي النَّخَلَاتِ بَيْنَ الْحَرَّتَيْنِ يُخْبِرُكُمْ بِمَا مَضَى وَبِمَا هُوَ كَائِنْ بَعْدَكُمْ. The wolf said to him, "Shall I not tell you of something more wonderful and something more strange? Go behind these trees, date trees." He was referring to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. "Go behind these date trees and you will find a man who is informing people of what happened in the past and what is to happen in the future." Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala, who is narrating this hadith, he says that this person, the shepherd, was a Jew. He came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and related this incident to him and embraced Islam. In the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, after relating this incident, the narrator says that Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam said, "Sadaq, والذي نفسي بيده لا تقوم الساعة حتى يكلم السباء الإنس ويخبره فخذه بما أحدث أهله بعده." That he has spoken the truth. "I swear by the one in whose hands my life is in, Qiyamah will not take place till beasts, till animals will begin to speak to mankind. Man's own thigh will inform him of what his family has been doing in his absence." Another sign that has not truly appeared in its true colors is that there will be so much wealth before the end of time that man will take a handful of gold or silver and he will look for people to accept this from him, and he will not find anybody who will accept this from him. Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates a hadith. فَبَيْنَمَا أَنَا عِنْدِ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ إِذْ أَتَاهُ رَجُلٌ فَشَكَى إِلَيْهِ الْفَاقَةَ. That we were in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when a man came and complained about poverty and starvation. Another man came to Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam and complained about highway robbers. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu ta'ala, "Jawu hadith, hal ra'ayta al-hira?" "Oh Adi, have you seen Hira?" Sayyidina Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied, "Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, lam araha wa kad unbi'tu anha." "I have not seen Hira." Hira is a city in Kufa, which is in Iraq, modern day Iraq. "Oh Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I have not seen Hira, but I've been informed about it." Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Oh Adi, ولئن طالت بك حياة لترين الضعين ترتحل من الحيرة حتى تطوف بالكعبة لا تخاف أحدا إن الله." "Wadi, if Allah gives you a long life, a day will come in which you will see a lovely young woman. She will travel by herself all the way from Hira in Iraq, and she will come to the house of Allah, and she will make tawaf of the house of Allah, and she will fear no dacoits, she will fear no highway robbers, she will fear nobody besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Wadi, ولئن طالت بك حياة لتفتحن كنوز كسرى." If Allah gives you a long life, you will see that the treasures of Kisra are open. "Wadi, if Allah gives you a long life, you will see that a man will come out with a handful of gold or silver, and he will be looking for people to take this gold and silver from him. He will find nobody that will be in need of this gold and silver." Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, the prophecies and the predictions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I saw with my very own eyes. A time had come when there was so much peace and security that a woman would travel all the way from Hira by herself, fearing no highway robbers, and she would come and she would perform Umrah, she would make du'af around the house of Allah, and she would return by herself. He says, "As for the treasures of Kisra, I was from amongst those people who conquered Persia, and we took the treasures and the booty from Persia." And he says, "O Muslim, if Allah gives you a long life, you will see the day when a man will come out with a handful of gold or silver looking for people to accept it from him, and he will not find a single person to accept it from him." Some scholars are of the opinion that this also took place at the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. At the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, there was so much wealth that a man would come out with a handful of gold and silver, but he would not find any needy man. He would find nobody in need of zakat, nobody in need of sadaqah, nobody in need of this wealth. We will see this happen again at the time of Imam Mahdi and at the time of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. There will be so much wealth in their time that the earth will take out its treasures, and the earth will take out its barakah, and nobody will be in need of sadaqah and zakah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَقِيُّ الْأَرْضُ أَفْلَاذَ كَبِدِهَا أَمْثَالُ الْأُسْتَوَانِ مِنَ الزَّهْبِ وَالْفِدَّةِ. That the earth will vomit
long pieces of its liver like columns of gold and silver. A murderer will come when he sees this gold and silver, he will say, "Tihaza qatal, did I kill for this?" One who broke his family ties because of wealth, he will come and say, "Tihaza qatahtu rahmi, did I break relations because of this?" A thief will come and say, "Tihaza qatah, was my hand cut off because of this?" And none of them will touch this gold and silver, and they will leave it. Another sign that has not appeared is that the Euphrates will disclose a mountain of gold. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِلَا تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ حَتَّى يَحْصُرَ الْفُرَاتَ عَنْ جَبَلٍ مِّنْ ذَهَبٍ يَقْتَتِلُ النَّاسِ عَلَيْهِ. That Qiyamah will not come till the river Euphrates will disclose a mountain of gold. People will fight over this gold. Out of every 199 will be killed. And every man will say to himself, لَعَلِّي أَكُونَ أَنَا الَّذِي أَنْجُو. It is possible that I am the one that will survive. The river Euphrates is a river which runs from Syria and Iraq and empties in the Gulf. Before the end of time, this river will disclose a mountain of gold. And people will fight for this gold. As for how this river will disclose a mountain of gold, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But one thing Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam has definitely told the Muslims is, كَمَنْ حَظَرْ فَلَا يَأْخُذْ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. Whoever is alive at the time and present when this river discloses a mountain of gold, he should not touch it and he should not take anything from it. Another thing that I like to mention here is that this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is authentic. There is no doubt in the hadith of Rasulullah. But there are people in this day and age which find it difficult to believe in this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they interpret this hadith as referring to not gold but to oil. This is completely wrong, because the words of the hadith are Jabalun, which is mountain in Arabic. For anybody that knows basic Arabic will tell you the word Jabal means mountain, and the word Zahab means gold. Gold is not called oil, and oil is not called gold. Secondly, if this hadith of Rasulullah was referring to oil, then what would be so special about the river Euphrates? Oil already comes out of land, it already comes out of water. So there would be nothing special if this hadith was referring to oil. And thirdly, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam has said that people will fight over this mountain of gold. In history, never has anybody fought over oil coming out from the river Euphrates or any other place. After this, a mountain will come out, a mountain of gold, and people will fight over this. Another sign that we have still not seen is the wind which will come from Sham, a cool breeze. It will enter the armpit of every Muslim, whereby every Muslim will die. In the long hadith regarding the Dajjal, in this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after mentioning the killing of Dajjal, how Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam will kill the Dajjal, in this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, thereafter Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam mentioned that the Muslims will remain for 7 years. Later, بَيْنَ إِثْنَيْنِ عَدَاوَةٍ, there will be no enmity between two Muslims. Then Allah will send this cool breeze from Sham, and it will enter the armpit of every Muslim, and it will extract his soul. No Muslims will remain. To the extent that if a Muslim enters the cave of a mountain, the wind will follow and take out his soul. In a lot of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can say that this wind, this cool breeze which will come from Sham, will appear when all the major signs have appeared. And after this wind, the worst of humankind, the worst of mankind will remain. Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani writes, reports a tradition which means that a woman will pass by a group of men. One of the men will raise her garment just like the tail of a sheep is raised, and he will commit zina with her in the public. A man will say from amongst them, only if you had gone behind the tree or behind some wall. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that this man will be like Abu Bakr and Umar amongst you. This is a sign that has not appeared to this very day. Another sign that has not appeared to this very day is a great war which will take place between the Muslims and the Christians. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, shall and prepare for six things before Qiyamah. And one of the things Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned was a peace treaty between the Muslims and the Christians. Then he sallallahu alayhi wasalam said that the Christians will break this peace and they will come with 80 flags. On the east flag, they will have 12,000 men. As for what will happen in this war, Usayr ibn Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates, في حاجة ريوحنا حمراء بالكوفة. Once there was a sandstorm in Kufa, and a man came repeating the words, يا عبدالله ibn Mas'ud جاء في الساعة, يا عبدالله ibn Mas'ud جاء في الساعة. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the hour has come. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud sat up and said, إِنَّ السَّاعَ لَا تَقُومْ حَتَّى لَا يُخْصَمْ مِيرَاثٌ وَلَا يُفْرَحْ بِغَنِيمَةٍ. That Qiyamah will not come till heritage is not divided and there will be no rejoicing over Mali Ghanimat, over booty. Then he said, أَدُوٌ يَجْمَعُونَ لِأَهْلِ الْإِسْلَامِ وَيَجْمَعُ لَهُمْ أَهْلُ الْإِسْلَامِ. That the enemy will muster strong against the Muslim and the Muslims will muster strong against the enemy. The narrator says, I asked, are you referring to the Christians? He said, yes. There will be a great fight between the Muslims and Christians. The hadith states, فَيَسْتَرِتُ الْمُسْلِمُونَ شَرْطَةً لِلْمَوْتِ لَا تَرْجُوا إِلَّا غَالِبًا فَيَقْتَتِلُونَ حَتَّى يَحْجِزَ بَيْنَهُمُ اللَّيْلِ فَيَفِيعُ هَؤُلَاءِ وَهَؤُلَاءِ كُلَّ غَيْرَ غَالِبٍ وَتَفْنَى الشَّرْطَةِ. But the Muslims and Christians will fight. The Muslims will select a detachment which will fight and promises that will keep on fighting till it dies or it will return victorious. They will fight and they will keep on fighting till the night intervenes. Night comes, the Muslims will return to their camp and the Christians will return to their camp. Nobody will be victorious and this detachment will be finished. Next day, the Muslims yet again will select a detachment to fight. Yet again they will fight the Christians and yet again the night will intervene. At night, the Muslims will return to their camp and the Christians to their camp. Nobody will be victorious and this detachment will all be finished. On the third day, the Muslims yet again will select a detachment for fighting and yet again they will fight with the Christians. And yet again, when the night intervenes, the Muslims will return to their camp and the Christians will return to their camp. On the fourth day, the narrator says, فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ رَابِعٍ نَفَدَ إِلَيْهِمْ بَقِيَّةُ أَهْلِ الْإِسْلَامِ. On the fourth day, the remaining Muslims will go fight with the Christians and Allah will bestow conquest upon the Muslims against the Kuffar. They will fight such a fight which has never been seen before. To the extent that if a bird happens to pass by their flank, the bird will not reach the other side till it will fall dead. Then, the children and one father who were 100 at one time will count the remainder and they will find out that only one survived. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, when this happens, which booty and mali ghanimat will be pleasing and which heritage will be divided when nobody remains? After this great war, another sign that has not appeared is that Constantinople will be conquered with takbir, with the sheer words, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu ajma'een, سمعتم بمدينة جانب منها في البر وجانب منها في البحر. Have you heard of a city half of which is in water? They said, نعم يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, كلا تقوم الساعة حتى يغزوها 70,000 من بني إسحاق. That Qiyamah will not come till 70,000 from the children of Ishaq will come and conquer Constantinople. Modern day Istanbul is Constantinople. They will come, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَلَمْ يُقَاتِلُوا بِسَلَاحٍ وَلَمْ يَرْمُوا بِسَحْمٍ. They will not fight with arms and nor will they shoot one single arrow. They will come to Istanbul, Constantinople. They will say, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. There is no God worthy of worship and Allah is the biggest, and one side will fall. They will say, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, for a second time, and the second side will fall. They will say, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, for the third time. They will enter, conquer Constantinople will be conquered, and they will acquire the booty. Now Constantinople to this very day, modern day Istanbul, has never been conquered without a fight and with the sheer word Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Sheikh Yusuf writes in his book that at the time of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'een, Yazid, Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, sent his son Yazid ibn Abi Yazid with an army consisting of the great Sahabi Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, and they came to conquer it, but it was not completely conquered. Then he writes, Sayyidina Muslima came and surrounded Constantinople, and its inhabitants agreed that a mosque should be made inside. As for the Turks, they did not conquer it without a fight, they conquered it with a fight. And at this moment in time, Turkey is in the hands of the Kuffar, and before the end of time, the Muslims will yet again conquer Istanbul, this time with Tasbih Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Another sign that has not appeared at this moment in time is, which has not appeared in its true colors, is the transformation of faces, the swallowing of the earth, and the raining of stones. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, يكون في آخر هذه الأمة خسف ونسخ وكسف. That in the latter part of this ummah, there will be the swallowing of the earth, there will be the transformation of faces, and there will be the raining of stones. Sayyidina Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates this hadith. He said to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أَنَحْلِكُ وَفِينَ الصَّالِحُونَ. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will we be destroyed when there are pious people amongst us? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, yes, إِذَا ظَهْرَ الْخَبَرُ. When evil prevails, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look. You will be destroyed even though there are pious people amongst you. Now this hadith of Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam has mentioned three things. Landslide, the swallowing of the earth. The second thing, the transformation of faces. And the third thing, raining of stones. As for the first thing, the swallowing of the earth, it has happened in the past and it will happen in the future. The great Imam Tabari relates in Riyaz al-Naqra that a group of Rawafid came to the governor of Madinah al-Munawwara, and they offered large sums of money and gifts. And then they requested that the governor give them permission to enter the room of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so that they could take out the bodies of Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, because they believed that these people were not worthy of resting next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the governor of Medina was weak. He accepted the gifts and money, and he called the gatekeeper of the sanctuary of the room of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him that when these people come, open the door for them and do not say anything to them. Let them do as they please. The gatekeeper says, at night when we closed the doors of the haram, 40 men came with shovels and lights, and they knocked on Babu Salah. He says, I opened the door as I was ordered by the governor. I opened the door and I went to one side of the masjid and began to cry. Ya Allah, what is this calamity that is befalling the Muslims? What is happening? He says, I kept on crying when all of a sudden I noticed that when these people reached the pulpit, the earth opened and the earth took these people inside. The governor was waiting at home for these people to come. When these people did not go home, the governor called me and asked me what is the situation. He says, I related the incident to him, but he didn't believe me. He said that I was mad. I said, oh governor, you can come, the earth is still there, the signs are still there, their clothes are still visible. In the year 208, the earth swallowed 13 villages in Morocco. In the year 346, there was an earthquake in Rai, and the earth swallowed the whole city of Talikan. It is written in the books of history that only 30 people survived. The earth swallowed 150 villages of Rai, and the earth quick spread. The second thing mentioned in this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the transformation of faces. The narrator says that we were three people traveling towards Yemen. We had with us a man who would swear to Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala and Sayyidina Umar. He was from Kufa, Al-Kufiyah. We would say to this man, stop swearing to these great people, they are the Sahaba. They were leaders of the Muslims, but he would refuse to believe us. And he would keep on swearing. He says, night came and we rested. In the morning we perform wudu and we woke this person from Kufa. Can you also get up and perform wudu? He said to us that he had seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a dream. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him that your faith is going to change at this very spot. He said, we told him to perform wudu. He says, all of a sudden his feet began to change. From the tip of his toes, all of a sudden his feet changed into the feet of a monkey. And within seconds, his whole body has changed into a monkey. They said, we tied him and put him onto our camel and we traveled. At the time of sunset, we reached a jungle in which there were many monkeys. This Kufian who had changed into a monkey. He changed into a monkey. When he saw these other monkeys, he broke the string and joined them. The final thing this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned was the raining of stones. In the year 1060, Allama Barzanji relates that in the year 1060, I was told that stones as big as chicken eggs fell in Kurdistan between Hizan and Kafr. So there are many signs that have still not appeared. And this is where I conclude my talk. So though majority of the signs have appeared, it does not mean that Qiyamah will take place and the descent of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam will take place at the turn of the millennium. Because there are many signs that are still yet to appear. And only when all these signs appear, will Qiyamah take place. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانًا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.